From Channel 2 News, on your side, Juneteenth, a celebration of freedom. Here is Channel 2's Mike Corbin.
Hello, everyone. I'm Mike Corbin, and welcome to our Channel 2 News special, Juneteenth, a celebration of freedom. Over the next half hour, we want to show you Buffalo's Juneteenth celebration and tell you what it's all about. It's more than food, music, and fun. It's also history, culture, and teaching our children the lessons of Juneteenth. This year's Juneteenth celebration will be held June 16th and 17th in Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Park at Best and Fillmore in Buffalo. It promises to be better than ever. Now, what exactly is Juneteenth, and why is it a story that needs to be told again and again? We begin now with Channel 2's Esther Miller with a story of how a Union general brought the belated news of emancipation and freedom to slaves in Galveston, Texas. The date, June 19th, 1865.
Let's all say it together.
Eva Doyle tells her Campus West fifth graders, for years, African slaves ran to the North for freedom, until Abraham Lincoln declared the Emancipation Proclamation, freeing all slaves. He sent soldiers to carry the word to the South and West, a tactic to end the Civil War.
He issued it in 1863, and many slaves actually did not get the official word of it until 1865. But when they found out that they were free, they wanted to really celebrate. So there were a lot of freedom festivals. That's why sometimes you'll hear Juneteenth referred to as a celebration of freedom.
June 19th was the day many slaves learned they were free. Texas, one of the last states.
And instead of saying 19th all the way, we have the term Juneteenth.
The festive period celebrates Juneteenth. History.
And some of the greatest abolitionists that we've known were Frederick Douglass, the Sojourner Truth, who went all around the country talking about how wrong it was to enslave human beings.
And she says Juneteenth in Buffalo celebrates family.
When you go to Juneteenth, it's like a big family reunion. It's a community reunion, people coming together. Perhaps you haven't seen a friend in 5 or 6 years, and here they are at Juneteenth, and you can renew those old acquaintances.
To learn more about Juneteenth, Doyle encourages students to come to her African Cultural Resource Center, started here in 1994.
Dozens of pictures, posters, and books, all of them to help kids learn more about African American history and culture.
African history is my passion, and so I try to express that through everything that I do. In my classroom, my teaching, pictures, they say 1,000 words. When a child looks at that picture, that says a lot. Abolitionists. Can you all say abolitionists?
Abolitionists.
Okay. It provides our teachers with the materials, with the resources that they need in order to do an effective job of teaching African and African American history.
It's a passion, she says, that gives history to the future and children appreciation for what they have today. Esther Miller, Channel 2 News.
Many school children are learning about the Western New York stops on the Underground Railroad. Many escaped slaves seeking freedom in Canada hid in the basement of the Michigan Street Baptist Church. Others stopped at Murphy Orchards in Newfane. Slaves would hide out in an underground room below the barn. And in Griffin Mills in southern Erie County, freedom seekers would huddle in an attic of a home now owned by Stephanie McCormick.
It was a heroic happening on the part of both races. It was real heroics. Imagine picking up and walking thousands of miles following the North Star to get to Canada. It was really pretty heroic.
On Buffalo's west side, a mural depicts a route to freedom. It shows a chain with a broken link at the Canadian border. Many people seeking a free life may have stopped at Buffalo's old canal district. Channel 2's Pete Gallivan tells us about the role a place called Doug's Dive may have played in the Underground Railroad.
The Canal District, a bustling weave of streets, bridges, and water. An economic barge that in the early 1800s sailed the village of Buffalo into economic prosperity. But amid, and some might say beneath it all, a subculture, one of brothels, saloons, and boarding houses.
What's interesting is that there was a culture of African Americans at this site. They weren't leading citizens. They weren't the people that built the churches or what have you, but they were part of the rough and tumble of this section of the Canal District.
Also part of the rough and tumble, a place called Doug's Dive, a dark cavern-like saloon in the basement of the old Union Block, which was also called the Negro Block. A place described in an 1874 newspaper article as the Black Hole of Buffalo. In a row of businesses only accessible from the canal towpath, it was certainly a place one could hide in plain sight.
It is beyond remarkable that indeed part of Doug's Dive survives.
The Inner Harbor Construction Project has drawn the foundation of Doug's Dive from legend into reality and out of its earthen hiding place.
Whether this in fact was an Underground Railroad site or not is will be of course very difficult to prove conclusively or in fact disprove.
But according to Tim Thielman of the Preservation Coalition, all signs point to that, including Uncle Doug himself. The 1860 census lists him as a steamboat cook. He was actually a former slave. Escaped or freed is not really known for sure, but he did have a reputation of being a good Samaritan to African Americans in need. Other clues include the fact that the entire block was owned by Elijah Effner, a Quaker. Quakers openly preached for abolition and helping slaves in their flight to freedom. But a huge indicator is the location itself.
You could stand right here in the Canal District. You could see freedom.
Freedom, a mile away. And there was also evidence of escaped slaves along this route.
This is where a ship docked in 1851 with a fugitive slave aboard. He was a cook on a ship, and a bounty hunter was waiting here for him.
Daniel Davis was beaten up on this very wharf and dragged off to jail, just steps from Doug's door.
It's very hard sometimes to document whether a site was an Underground Railroad site because, you know, you don't have an advertising sign out
right.
saying, fugitive slaves, please stop here.
Whether it was or it wasn't is debatable, but what is for sure is this area was home to a strong-willed, hard-working people who played a big role in building a city.
This site is very important to Buffalo history. Not only African-American history, but the history of everyone.
In Buffalo, Pete Gallivan, Channel 2 News.
The future of Doug's Dive is in doubt. Right now, only part of the foundation remains. Officials must decide if that foundation is worth preserving. Well, the local faces of those who helped pave the road to freedom. That's still ahead on Juneteenth, a celebration of freedom. And throughout our special, a look at how other cities across the nation remember Juneteenth. Stay with us. Welcome back. The stories of African American history can really be told by looking at the faces of those who inspire change. As Channel 2's Esther Miller tells us, many of those have ties to Western New York.
When slaves escaped to freedom from the South, many passed through Western New York to Canada with the help of people who lived in our area, like Harriet Tubman.
It's uncertain exactly how Harriet Tubman moved fugitive slaves across New York State into Canada. We do know that at some time she crossed at the suspension bridge in Niagara Falls, near where the Whirlpool Bridge is today. She lived for a time in St. Catharines, Ontario, which is right across the border, before moving on to her final home in Auburn, New York.
Spokesman Frederick Douglass lived to the east in Rochester. His eloquence was first noticed in a local church. These pews are preserved as part of that history here at the Frederick Douglass Museum in Rochester.
The newspapers highlight his presence. There again, they called him the presence of a majestic king, they called him there, in the newspapers. And he sat on one of these pews. He moved here in 1847, as I said before, in September. By December, his newspaper was up and running. He left here in 1872 because his house was mysteriously burned down.
In 1895, Frederick Douglass died of a massive heart attack in Washington, D.C. In his will, he asked to be buried here at Mount Hope Cemetery. He said because the best 25 years of his life was here in Rochester.
Mary Talbert lived in Buffalo, next to the Michigan Avenue Baptist Church, which still stands today. She entertained those like W.E.B. Du Bois, her house, the site of influential debates.
Buffalo really can point to that spot next to the Michigan Avenue Church, where the Talbert House stood, as being a birthplace of the Niagara Movement and subsequently the NAACP.
Other local influential names include Sojourner Truth and Ida B. Wells, who refused to move to the Negro section of a Northern train.
She says in her book, "They threw me off the train, parasol and all." Ida B. Wells sued and won.
And all these local people influenced thousands of lives fleeing slavery in the South and changed the face of Western New York and America. Esther Miller, Channel 2 News.
Someone who's taken pictures of many faces is Buffalo photographer Simba Malay. He first picked up a camera in 1959, and since then he's taken thousands of photos of famous people in Buffalo. Faces like Bill Cosby, Bishop Desmond Tutu, and Sugar Ray Leonard. His favorite photos reflect the 70s movement and the struggle of the black community.
Stories, and we had a thing in the 60s that we wanted to rewrite our own history. Okay, and a lot of my photos show that, because I believe the only weapon that Martin Luther King, Marcus Garvey, and Malcolm X, and those people, the only weapons they had was the truth.
You can see Simba's work entitled Black Rhythms on display at the Buffalo and Erie County Historical Society through July 1st. A local woman with ties to Harriet Tubman. We'll learn more about the feisty woman who led slaves to freedom next on Juneteenth, a celebration of freedom. Maybe you agree that everyone needs heroes. The best kinds of heroes are people like us, people we can connect with. Harriet Tubman fills that bill. Many people don't know that Harriet Tubman has a relative living right here in Buffalo. Here's Channel 2's Rich Kalman.
That's her name on what has long been Michigan Avenue in Buffalo, Harriet Tubman Way.
Put her name up there.
That's what Arlene Olden told Buffalo City leaders. After all, Michigan Avenue was a key route on the Underground Railroad. And Harriet Tubman was one of its leading conductors.
Harriet Tubman was a very tiny woman. She was also very mean.
She carried a pistol. She threatened fellow slaves who wanted to turn back, live north or die, she'd say. 300 slaves went north with her and lived.
We were always taught that.
From
as little
when
children.
You were a little girl?
Yes. That's the only way we knew. Because it was not taught in school.
Arlene Olden knows because she is Harriet Tubman's great-grandniece. That's Arlene on the left. Her mom took her and her cousin to the library each Friday. They took out books by black authors and poets. The family spent summers in Auburn, New York, where their renowned relative eventually settled. Tourists now flock to the home where she lived. Arlene Olden says Harriet Tubman was motivated by a deep belief.
She knew deep in her heart slavery was wrong.
26 years ago, Arlene Olden helped found the Harriet Tubman 300 Club to tell the story. If you've ever gone fishing near the Peace Bridge, you might have seen what they've done. They put up an historic marker just across from Canada. It recites the astounding fact that many slaves had to cross to Canada to find freedom.
The Canadians have really done this for years and years. They've preserved our heritage better than we have.
Members of the 300 Club 2 years ago were planting a tree on Michigan Avenue at Sycamore Street to remember Harriet Tubman.
Man stopped. He was a young man, but he said, "What is all this?" Which is an opportunity. And he said, "Gee, you know, that's something I never knew." I said, "Well, now you do. Bring your children."
Arlene Olden has 3 grandchildren. Her home is filled with photos and paintings for them to teach them about heroes, about ordinary people spurred on by circumstance to rise to greatness.
You got to have a hero. You got to have a hero.
Researchers now believe Harriet Tubman was born Harriet Ross in Maryland in 1820. Her parents came from the Ashanti tribe in West Africa. Well, a theater that's making great strides in the African American community and the storytelling of Karima Amin. That's all next on Juneteenth, a celebration of freedom. Welcome back to Juneteenth, a celebration of freedom. One of Buffalo's oldest centers of African American culture is soon due for a facelift. Once again, here's Channel 2's Esther Miller.
What you staring at, boy?
From the real life story of Emmett Till to
There he is, the man of power, Jackie Roosevelt Robinson.
It's black history on stage with a soulful flair.
I want a man that when he snores will blow the best clothes off.
It's the Paul Robeson Theater.
It's a home-based performing arts center, which means that we utilize people from the community. Some people have never been on stage before at all.
And they start early here. African dance classes for the tots, stage production for the teens, and drumming for any age. A mission started in 1958 by Malcolm Ernie. 43 years later, these plans to expand are on the drawing board, a vision of George K. Arthur.
If we can bring in more kids, we can expose more kids to the arts and to the culture. It means an awful lot.
He's lobbying for nearly $4 million to build this by 2002, inside an expanded stage and classrooms for the arts. It'll stretch the current building from here to half a block on Maston Avenue. Good news to Agnes Bain.
We are leaking now with the roof and the dance chamber floor is caving in, so we're real excited.
She says for years, stage directors struggled with limited space.
For a scene change, actors have to go through a makeshift door in the men's room, go through the boiler room, leap over and under pipes, and finally get to their spot on stage on time.
Stage directors can now dream bigger, giving these faces something to truly dance about. Yes. Esther Miller, Channel 2 News.
Stories have always been a part of our history. They tell us who we are, they remind us of our past, and help us prepare for the future. Karima Amin is a Western New York storyteller who brings her stories to area school children. Channel 2 News photographer David Harrington brings us Karima Amin and the story Keep On Steppin'.
You know, way back in the old days, in the days of slavery, when it was legal for one man to own another, there was an enslaved African whose name was Dave. And Dave worked on a plantation somewhere in Tennessee. Dave worked as he always did under a hot blazing sun, and one afternoon he heard something strange. He stopped for just a moment to listen. He heard children crying and screaming and calling for help. He looked out across the fields, and there, in the middle of the river, he saw the slave master's two children, a little boy and a little girl, and a little boat. The children had lost their oars, and the boat was in danger of tipping over. Without a moment's hesitation, Dave threw down his shovel, and he struck off across the fields, running. And he leaped into the water, and he saved those children. Now, you might think that the slave master would have given Dave his freedom right then and there for such a heroic act. But he didn't. He said instead, Dave, I'll free you next year. Work for me for one more year, bring in a good crop, fill up the barn, and you'll be free. Dave said, fine. And he did work for one more year, worked harder than he had ever worked, worked so hard he filled up the barn and half the house. And now it was time for him to be free. He began to gather up his few belongings. The old slave master gave him an old suit of clothes and a few more things, and he tied everything together in a bundle. And he placed that bundle on the end of a stick, and then he placed that stick on his shoulder, and he set out on the road going north. Heading toward freedom. The old slave master watched him for a long time and then finally called after him, "Hey, Dave! You know I love you, Dave. I love you." And Dave said, "Yes, sir." But he kept on stepping. The master called again, "Hey, Dave! You know old Missy likes you fine, Dave." And Dave said, "Yes, sir." But he kept on stepping. The master watched for a time and then called out a third time. "Hey, Dave! The children love you, Dave. Indeed they do. The children loves you just fine, Dave." And Dave said, "Yes, sir." But he kept on stepping. After looking at him for a very long time, the master finally called out a fourth time, leveling the unkindest cut of all. He said, "Hey, Dave! I don't care where you go, Dave. You never be nothing." Dave just smiled to himself and said, "I got to keep on stepping. Night or day, I got to keep on stepping. I'm on my way. Got to keep on stepping. Hot or cold, got to keep on stepping. I got to be bold. Got to keep on stepping." You're talking about self-determination. You're talking about a people struggling to be free. You're talking about a people who always knew that it was meant for them to be free. They had been free. Freedom was not lost. It was simply a matter of enforcing what they already had on the inside. Keep on stepping. And he did, too. Some folks say he went to Philadelphia where he could be free. Some folks say he came right here to Buffalo, New York. I don't know if that's true either. Some say he went all the way to Canada where he settled and where he could be free. Now, that might be true, too. Now, I don't know what's really true about where Dave ended up, but I know this. Dave was always free. In his mind and in his heart, he had always carried the seed of freedom. And Dave knew something that all of us must remember. You're never, ever free as long as you allow someone else to control your destiny. You got to keep on stepping, keep on stepping, keep on stepping.
That story is called Keep On Steppin', and it was written by Julius Lester. Karima found it in a book of black folk tales. Well, that's our Channel 2 News special, Juneteenth, a celebration of freedom. We hope you enjoyed learning the story of Juneteenth, how a Union general brought the belated news of emancipation to Galveston, Texas, the date June 19, 1865. And don't forget to come down and enjoy Buffalo's Juneteenth celebration. That's on Saturday and Sunday, June 16th and 17th at Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Park on Best Street here in Buffalo. Everyone is invited. Thanks for watching. We'll see you down at Juneteenth.